Albion, we are a word church. And actually what the music minister just sang, they sang out the scripture. So in John chapter 3, there was the conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus. Jesus says, you must be born again. Nicodemus asks and says, how can a man enter into his mother's womb a second time? Jesus says, marvel not. Don't think it's strange. Don't think it's even a big deal. Marvel not. You must be born again. Now, I know Macedonia is a church that responds to scripture. So the next time you hear them singing scripture, don't be sitting there like you think you can even. Lord have mercy. But if you pay to get in, we're going to refund your money. You must be born again. Before we move on into our welcome, I do want to encourage you because from my pastoring position, I'm looking and I'm seeing and I'm sensing some things. There's a lot of people in here right now got some other things on your mind. I ain't even got to ask you. I know it. You have come in with a heaviness on your mind. So while they think in your mind already wondering, I need you all the way here. Can I just simply encourage you, whatever is on your mind, you ain't gonna fix it right here, right now. So forget about yourself. Concentrate on Him and worship Him. And if you just try worshiping just one time, you may find out that by the time you get back to your situation not changed. We understand that life has its challenges. We understand that many of our challenges sometimes don't end when we want them to. But we also want to encourage you that Jesus Himself made you a promise. Whenever life feels like it's hard, Jesus made you a promise. He says, come unto me, all ye that are. All of you got something on your mind. All of you who are heavy laden. All of you who got the weight of the world on your shoulders. All of you who got more problem than you got solution. He says, come unto me. All you who are heavy laden. And He made you a promise. He says, I'll give you. I just want to encourage you this morning, like, rest your mind. Just rest your mind. Listen, rest in your worship today. Let everything else go. It's like when you go to a nice facility or restaurant, and or even Macedonia, they check your coat. You don't sit in the place not thinking about your coat. Because usually when you check your coat, they give you a ticket for your coat. And your ticket gives you the right to redeem your coat. But we're saying, check your problem. And by the time it's done, you won't redeem your problem, you'll redeem a solution. Say rest. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you something you don't have. I'll give you a gift called rest. How many of us in our most honest time would tell somebody else, I have trouble concentrating. I have trouble staying asleep all night. I got a little worryation in my mind and my heart. I can't really get no rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. He said, because I am meek and lowly in heart. He says, I'm not just big old Jesus sitting on the throne. I'm coming down to the very common man. Right in your situation, no matter how big or how small it is, I'm concerned with what's going on in your life. You are not going through what you're going through by yourself. We have walked in here with a look on our face like, don't nobody understand what I'm going through. It's been so hard for me. I could barely make it. Well, baby, the reason you walked in the door today is because somebody else had to wait in that room. You didn't make it through what you made it through by yourself. You ain't that strong. You don't have that much endurance, because if you had to do it by yourself, you would crush, you would have crumbled on Monday. Tuesday would have took you out. Wednesday would have worked your nerves. Thursday you would have been through. Friday would have been final for you. And Saturday you would have completely saturated everything you thought was still left. But how many of you know it's Sunday morning? At least by Friday, it can't stay on Sunday morning. It tried to kill you on Friday. You buried it on Saturday. It stayed dead all night Saturday night. But you got up on Sunday morning. Ain't no need to try to go back and rehash and worry about what happened on Friday. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. He says, for my yoke is easy. You thought it was hard. You worrying about stuff. Why you worrying about easy stuff? He said, my yoke is easy. What he's really saying to somebody, he says, learn more about me. And when you learn more about me, you'll actually think more about me. And if you think more about me, you'll figure out when you think about me, your situation get easier. Because when you think about him, you will figure out that if death couldn't keep him, a problem can't stop you. Come on, y'all gotta get with me. I just see God's people suffering more than you should this morning. Oh, no, see, y'all still ain't feeling me. Y'all still ain't feeling me. Before we welcome our guests, because I need the atmosphere right. And the atmosphere right now is a little too heavy in here. Can I testify just for a second? 30 days ago, fourth Sunday, September, I was laid up in a hospital in Grand Rapids. Watch this. Should have been dead. Should have been dead. God himself showed up in a hospital room and brought me back from death and brought me to life. And it dealt with blood in my lungs. Blood clots over the course of time kept going from my right leg and lodging in my lungs on both sides, to the point that on the right side of my body, my lungs was pressing against my heart. But I'm here today. I found that I wasn't really worried when I was in the hospital because I had a blood issue. See, those that know him, those who have come unto him and learned of him, they respond when they heard the blood. See, somebody must have known what the blood is. I wasn't really worried because I had a blood issue. A boss who had a blood issue on Friday on the hill, called Calvary. They put me in the emergency room on a Friday afternoon with a blood issue. I stayed in the hospital all day Saturday, but on Sunday my blood issue was going away. I knew a man who had a blood issue on a Friday. His blood was shed on Friday. He died and he stayed dead all Saturday. But his blood issue was gone because early Sunday morning, with all power in his head, he got it. Am I talking to anybody up in here? No matter what's going on in my life, ain't no way in the world I'm gonna be sad today.
I see some smiles on your faces now.
Yeah. We all right now.
Y'all go ahead and have a seat. We all right now.
We all right.
I wish I could really sing. I wish I could, Sister Bell. I wish I could really sing. I really do. I ain't gonna sing it, but I'll just tell you what the words I really sing.
It's a song we sang way down in Mississippi. And the lyrics just said, Lord, I know you've been so good.
Yeah. Somebody know this song.
Yeah.
It says, Lord, I know you've been so good. You watched over me all night long. Lord, I know you've been so good. Said I could have been dead. Sleeping in my grave. Made no death, no waiting for that made him behave to be good. That's how I feel. Lord, I know you've been so good.
Thank you.
song. Mr. Spice before the Christmas party. Y'all better stop. Oh, yeah. Oh, y'all better stop.
Hey!
Go and give him your war cry. Go and give him your war cry. Go and give him your war cry. Go ahead and give him your war cry.
Come in to be mad all the time. We
ain't that church that fight with each other?
Amen.
Now we are family.
Amen.
And even your natural family get some disagreements. So don't necessarily have a higher expectation for us than you have for your own family. Because a lot of times you the one raising hell in your own family. Together, Brother Glenn, when we come together, Brother Glenn, we get it together. Listen, if I was mad with you on last Sunday, that was last Sunday. You remember as kids, way back when you and your best friend just get out there and just flat out start fighting. And I, like 15 minutes later, thinking of thieves. Listen, if we fought with you on last week, that was last week. We're friends again. You might not want to be my friend, but you're my friend. We got a good thing here. God has blessed us here at the Macedonia Church. And we don't want to bring amazing down to average. What we do, we lift up the name of Jesus. And let me take you back to last Wednesday, and we don't get offended. We do not get offended. Why do we ask me why? Because we read a scripture. Psalms 119, 165. It says, great is thy peace that's in your law, and nothing shall offend me. I love what the scripture says. It says you have peace first. And if you got peace, why would you take something that you don't need? If you got peace, the only way you got peace comes from the Prince of Peace. And the Prince of Peace never brings offense to you. So then something or somebody else brought offense to you. And it was Satan. And offense is a trap from Satan. Jesus said in Luke chapter 17, verse 1, he said, it is impossible but that offenses should come. In other words, every single person, every day, is going to have the opportunity to be offered offenses. Some people will offer you an offense and they didn't know they was offering you an offense. Because we don't always know what's going to make you mad. You kind of like got a hair trigger sometimes. Like you snap out in a heartbeat. It don't take much for the wind blow wrong, you mad. I didn't know I was supposed to come to you, walk sideways, walk back, come back here, and do a square dance with you. I didn't know that. I didn't know that was going to set you off today. So I offered an offense to you, but I didn't mean to. But it's still your responsibility not to take the offense. It's a trap. And if by chance, my brothers and my sisters, you find yourself being offended, please don't be so bragging about it.
That's right.
You offended me. Oh, really?
In the trap.
At least repent and move on. Let me sit there talking about somebody that offended you.
That's right.
Because as a believer, what you done said is, I took the trap from the bait from Satan. And you got to deal with it.
Yeah.
I knew I'm coming to somebody this morning. A believer, even though you have the opportunity to be offended, you have no biblical right to be offended. So Sunday morning is not the opportunity to come in here with your jaw swollen. I I know we got a people part. We're gonna get some announcements here real quick.
Teach us.
But let me hurry up and tell you.
Yes, sir.
If you come to this church, yes, let me tell you about Macedonia.
Yes, sir.
We are a passionate church.
Yes.
Which means every now and again we may say something get on your nerve.
That's right. Yeah. What you said?
What you didn't recognize is that God allowed you to test to see where you were for you. Because if you can't deal with us and we really ain't gonna harm you, how in the world when you get back home and the devil start attacking your mind, how you gonna deal with him? Listen, I may say the wrong thing the wrong way, but I love you. He ready to like you. Steal, kill, and destroy. And you don't get mad at me and won't come to church talking about you church hurt. Are you serious?
Preach.
Do I have that much power over Preach. You that you won't stay away from your blessing and go back home and let the devil torment you because you're in a trap? Are you serious? You gave me too much credit and you took too much for yourself. But I can tell you there's no such thing as church hurt in Macedonia. Because if you don't come in here and tell me about your home hurt,
what?
Don't come in here and talk about no church hurt. You get your brains beat in at home and you don't come to church talking about somebody offended me. We just have hurt. That's all it is. I said it Wednesday, I said it again. It don't matter where I get hurt at. I don't want to get hurt. You didn't hurt me more at church than you hurt me out in the street when you talking about me and cussing me out.
What you say?
I don't want to get hurt nowhere. And so we ain't gonna talk about home hurt, church hurt, neighborhood hurt, job hurt, school hurt, relationship hurt, husband hurt, wife hurt, children hurt. We ain't gonna talk about that. Don't come up here talking about no church hurt. That's a term that has been banned from the Macedonian vocabulary. And the other reason we know it's been banned, because we're a Bible church. Jesus says, if any man desire to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. We said it Wednesday night. A cross, we glorify it, we romanticize it, but a cross was a death instrument. Which means if you take up a cross, something's gonna hurt you. Something is going to hurt you. It is designed to hurt you because the cross now for us is designed to kill something in you that is preventing you from following Christ like you should. Because when all y'all turn against me, I can still turn to him. I'm teaching this morning. We have a God who's downloading to the pastor right now to talk to the people. Yeah. While the people are being taught, the young people are in place for ministry and they ain't moving. We got a good thing here, y'all. Don't make amazing, be average. And for all of you who cannot stay out of drama. Here's my quote to you. We're going to get some announcements. We're going to do our offering. So you might as well get your little envelopes ready. Watch this. Here's my quote to you. Don't just be extra. Be extraordinary. just be extra. Be extraordinary.
Yes, sir.
God didn't call us just to be ordinary. And he sure didn't call us to have all this drama.
I
don't know about you, but can somebody agree with me? I did not get out of my bed this morning by the power of the Holy Ghost. I did not get in that shower. I did not put this nice little suit on. I did not drive back from Kalamazoo after I had to drive from Albion to Kalamazoo at 3:30 this morning. I did not come to this church for no drama. I came to lift up the name of Jesus. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. And my praise is more important to me than your drama. So excuse me while I ignore your drama, while I lift up the name Jesus, for it is at the name of Jesus that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. You are not my boss. You ain't gonna knock me off my square. You ain't gonna get me up off my path. I know that he's the one who is the one that's most important to me. So if you got some drama for me today, hold that thing the next ride. I'm on fire this morning. Come on, come on. Is that all right?
Good morning, Macedonia.
Good morning.
So, obedience requires new members' orientation is second and fourth Sundays at 9:30 a.m. and Tuesdays at 6:30 p.m. First service and Bible study is Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. and Sunday fellowship. Sunday school is at 9:30 a.m. and worship service is 11 at 11 a.m.
Amen.
Sister Rynisha Beans ministry. The ministry licensing service for Sister Rynisha Beans will be today at 3:30 p.m.
Amen.
Please invite everyone you know to come witness and celebrate what God is doing in Macedonia.
Amen. Amen.
Fifth pastoral anniversary banquet. On November 9th at 6 p.m., we will be having a celebration banquet at the Upper Baldwin Hall at Albion College.
Amen.
Please see Minister Shauna and Spicer to purchase a ticket. The tickets cost $35 and all proceeds go to the cost of the event. It is a formal event, so please dress your best.
Amen.
Fifth pastoral anniversary service. Our pastor's fifth year pastoral anniversary service will be November 10th at 3:30 p.m. Dinner will be served at 1:30 p.m. The preacher bringing the word will be Dr. Addis Moore from Mount Zion Baptist Church. Annual Church Business Meeting. The annual church business meeting will be held November 12th at 7 p.m. All members of Macedonia are welcome to attend.
All right.
Amen.
Weekly music rehearsals. Triumphant Adult Praise Dance is Sundays after the worship service. Voice of Macedonia and Tequila Adult Praise is Saturday before first and third Sunday at 11 a.m. Chosen Generation and Tequila Youth Praise is Saturday before second and fourth Sunday at 11 a.m. And Triumphant Youth Praise Dance is Saturdays at 12:30 p.m.
Amen.
Good morning, Macedonia. I came to let you all know that the ticket sales are going very, very well for Pastor's Anniversary. And to those of you who need to purchase your tickets today, please see Sister Minister Charnette Spicer after service today. The one thing though, we're going to have a meeting immediately after the service for all of the church leaders right over here in the L. We want to do that as quickly as possible so you can get downstairs and eat. So Sister Minister Charnette will be available for you to get those tickets right away. And she'll join us shortly afterwards. I have money in my pocket now for two tickets.
Amen.
And we're going to make sure we get those to her, and I'll get those to those of you who gave me money. I'll get you those tickets right away. Again, we just want to be prayerful for our pastor for these 5 years. And we want to support this weekend 110%. So I'm just asking everybody to please make sure that you support by purchasing a ticket for that beautiful banquet and being here the following day. It's going to be a lot of people here. And as Pastor said, the lot of people should be us first.
Amen.
Y'all got that? So when we get here, we should have to give up our seats for them.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we're looking forward to meeting you all after church today, especially all the leaders very quickly. And thank you very much.
All right.
Oh, the colors for the banquet and the weekend is going to be purple, gray, and white. Any combination there. So if you don't have purple, just wear all white, whatever. Just come to church.
Amen.
We're here to celebrate these 5 wonderful years and looking forward to 50 more.
Amen.
Thank you to Sister Christina Crawford and her crew for putting together an amazing event on this past Friday for our young adults. Amen. Thank you for that. Want to invite all who can and will to come out on Tuesdays at 6:30.
Yes, sir.
We have a new teaching class called Members Continuous Christian Education.
Amen.
If you just want to know more about Word, just come on and hang out with us. I promise you it'll be worth your time. I promise you that. We will be participating in the Trunk or Treat event, if you will, that is over at the Free Methodist Church, as we have done the last 4 or 5 years. And so meet us over there at 6 o'clock, I believe. And they always look for us. And we have our little table set. They got a little section for us. So we will be doing that once again this year. Teachers training is this Saturday for all our teachers who are going through teachers training. Amen. And y'all know what y'all supposed to have when you come here. And so just come in ready to do what you're supposed to do. This is Breast Cancer Awareness or Cancer Awareness Month.
Amen.
Praise God for all. Amen. Praise God for all of you who put a little pink on today in recognition of that. We did it last week, but I'm going to do it one more time. All of you who, now listen at the language I'm going to use. I'm not saying you are a survivor. I'm going to call you a cancer conqueror. Yeah. Scripture says we are more than conquerors. Amen. So if you are a cancer conqueror, would you please stand at this time?
Hallelujah.
Amen. 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 These individuals right here are proof positive of what God can do. Won't be doing it. In those times when you were really scared, in those times when you were sure you could make it through, when your chemo and your radiation and all of that medicine, and you felt weak in your body and just didn't feel like you could get out of bed, who would have thought? When you felt at your worst, that on a day like today, you were on your feet. You are a cancer conqueror through Him that loved you. Congratulations, and to God be the glory. Amen. Let's get ready to give. Let's get ready to give. Let's get ready to give. As you well know, we have a preacher in the house today, so we're going to have the preacher ready to preach at about 12:15, so we're going to do this very quickly. And so as you get your envelopes ready, I don't know what I did with mine, but as you get your envelopes ready, let's get ready to give real quick. That ain't it. That is right there, hiding from you. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we thank you right now for the blessing of financial resources. Thank you, God, for allowing us the privilege to give back to you. Lord, some of us may not have a lot, but what we have, we give back to you in obedience, knowing that we can never beat you giving. And when we give, you'll give back to us good measure,
pressed down, shaken together, running over. And we thank you right now, God, that everyone in the sound of my voice, whether they're given out of need, out of lack, or out of overflow, Lord, that you bless them with whatever they stand in the need, according to your riches and glory. So we thank you right now for being who you are as we obey you to our very best. In Jesus' name, amen. I'll start giving off all of our preachers, our deacons, trustees, then you, my sisters and my brothers. At this time, would you please stand, face the walls, and ushers will direct you from the rear very quickly.
All right. Amen.
Amen.
Because see, one thing I know, my comfort zone. And we're talking about today, our sermon topic is living outside of your comfort zone. Amen? Living outside of your comfort zone. Amen? That's one thing I want to push, because one thing Pastor even mentioned, he said, why are you trying to be, instead of, we supposed to be at an elite level, and y'all coming in here down here. Amen? He said, that's not where you're supposed to be. Amen? That's not who God created you to be. He created you to be excellent. Amen? Is not extraordinary. Like God didn't do something magnificent for you today. Like he didn't wake you up this morning. Like he didn't give you food on your table. Like he didn't give you health and strength. Amen. Like he didn't allow you to see a day he knows you don't deserve. Why are we choosing to be Jesus. So in our scripture today, and for those who didn't skim just yet, we're dealing with Abraham, amen? And everybody kind of know the story about Abraham, because Abraham had to, he was told by God, or challenged by God, to actually sacrifice his son. Right? Amen? That's what the story is all about, y'all, okay? Amen. So here we are, we're talking about Abraham. And one thing we are going to learn from this is that through Abraham, we will learn how to live outside of our comfort zone.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
That comes. So living outside of your comfort zone requires you, number one, to expect godly instruction.
Ooh.
Expect it. Amen. Verse 1 and 2. I'm going to hit it real quick. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to Abraham, and he said, here I am. He said to him, Abraham, he said, here I am. Then he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Amen? So it says, now it came to pass after these things. I was saying, what in the world happened? What happened? What happened? What happened? Well, what happened was, and here it is, Abraham became a dad. At an old age. Amen. It's a miracle. How many of y'all know God is working some miracles right now in your life? You don't even see them yet. They at your door knocking. And he's just waiting on you to just come on in. Amen. Say, I believe God.
I believe God.
You got to stop being uncomfortable. So Abraham had went through a blessing. Amen. He received a son at an older age. And it was a miraculous thing. And so he went through some things. Now, stick with me. I'm going quick. 21. Verse 21. Chapter 21. Abraham actually goes through the fact that this son grows up. And then this son comes in contact with this other son who, come to find out, is his brother. And so now, Sarah is a little upset. Because she said, wait a minute, hold up. Wait a minute. No, you need to, Abraham, you need to get him out of here. You need to get him out of here because, No. I want him and the baby mama out. Now, you hear what I'm saying? She said, she got to go. You know, I don't care where she go, but you're going to have to get her out of here. Amen. I don't care what you do. Amen. So Abraham, the first thing he does is he asks God.
He asks God.
Expect godly instruction. Stick with me. I'm coming back to 22. Y'all just stick with me. He expected godly instruction. So Abraham, even though he didn't want to, he did what God said.
Yeah.
Amen. So as he did what God said, we get back to where we are in 22, and it says, after these things. So now y'all know what these things is, right? All right. We good. We good. We run. So here it is. Abraham. After Abraham obeys God, God then feels it's time to test Abraham.
Oh, no.
I need you to understand that after you obey God, it don't mean it's time to kick up your feet. Amen. It don't mean that now you're just in war and you can quit fighting. Amen. It means that you can expect for some things to come up.
Yes, sir.
After he obeyed, God said, I'm a tester. I want to test his faith, and I want to hear and see what Abraham's going to do.
Right.
Now, it looks like after God actually calls Abraham, the first thing Abraham does is answer.
Yes, he did.
room, because y'all look at me like, who cares? Guess what? How many times have you got busy doing your thing, and you didn't miss the word of God, because you so comfortable doing you, that you didn't expect godly instruction to tell you what to do? You missed it. You didn't know that God came up to you because you were supposed to be a blessing, or that woman came up to you because she was supposed to bless you. Your only son Isaac, who you love, and I wanna bother that for just a minute, because I'm sitting there saying, how can he say your only son?
Your only son. Wow.
We just got to talk about his brother,
yeah,
and the baby mama,
and the baby mama,
and all that drama in 21. Wow. So how can you call him an only son?
Yes.
When he's not.
Yeah.
I'ma hit it quick, because I got to go.
Okay.
That needed to bring something special.
Lord,
can I tell you right now that God has created something for you,
yes,
that only you can do?
Yes.
I don't care how many baby mamas, grandmas called out.
Yes.
You!
Yes.
He created you for that thing. Amen?
Yes.
So I need you to look at your neighbor and say, expect godly instruction.
Yes.
I need you to look at another one and say, expect godly instruction.
Yes.
Because God is going to be talking to us.
Yeah.
We ain't got time to be comfortable.
Yeah.
Sitting up eating bonbons, we ain't paying no attention to God said he's screaming, and we ain't paying no attention to what he's trying to say. He's saying, you need to go. You need to come. You need to leave him. You need to quit. You need to stop. You need, and you just sitting there, I'm going to pray on it.
Yeah.
When did he do that?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
When you are outside your comfort zone, you keep an eye and an ear for God. Because one thing about Abraham, he showed you. He said, you know what? The first thing is, if I hear the voice of God,
yes,
he recognized who it was,
yeah,
and he listened to the details of what he said. Now, what part of that is you? Do you recognize him when he told? Do you even hear him? And when he tells you what to do you do it? I'm going on. Y'all looking at me like, oh my God. My God. He's talking. The question is, are you listening? Ask your neighbor. Say, are you listening? Tell your other neighbor. Say, are you listening? See, living outside of your comfort zone requires you to expect godly instruction. But also, number two is exhibit total faith. Now, this one is actually covered 3 through 10. Now, how I'm going to run that? Y'all watch God. Watch God. So after God gives a word, the next thing you must do is actually do what he said.
Yeah.
Now Abraham shows us how in his response. In verse 3, Abraham rose early in the morning. Tell your neighbor, get up.
Yeah.
I need you to hit that piece because we'll gloss over it like it's nothing. I asked somebody the other day, I said, well, what time do you get up? He said, I don't get up till 12 or 1. Huh? Abraham lifted his eyes and saw a place far off. Now here it is, when he sent Isaac forward to where God is trying to take us.
Yes.
So Abraham rose early in the morning so he can get set his eyes on the place that God had created for him to go, so he can do what God created him to do. Amen. I need you to hear that. God is trying to speak to you. You won't get up and do the last thing he said because you don't know where you're going. He said if you get up and start moving, I'll direct your path so you don't have to worry about a thing. I'll make sure everything pans out in your favor because I know what's best for you. Verse 5, 6, 7. Abraham is settling or setting things up to obey God. He's not questioning God or telling him his opinion. He's moving with a plan to obey. Somebody say total faith. In verse 8, Abraham's faith had to increase because he's talking to his son who has no clue that he is about to be sacrificed. It's one thing to have to sacrifice your son. It's another to have to try to get that face right so he don't.
Yeah. Yes.
He was lied on, talked about, mistreated, but he kept living outside of his comfort zone.
Yes.
Because he had you in mind.
Yes.
Say me.
Yes.
He had you in mind.
Uh-huh.
My God. When they held up high and stretched him wide,
uh-huh,
he still kept living outside of his comfort zone.
Yes.
It couldn't have been comfortable.
Faith kept you from staying away from church today. And you heard some instruction, and one of the instructions was, come unto me. If that's you today, and you're ready to live outside your comfort zone, it's very simple. The Bible says, if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart God is raising from the dead, you shall be saved. If you're here today, and you know that the preacher was talking to you, would you come at this point? It's not too late. This is your time. Even if it's uncomfortable, it's time to live outside your comfort zone. Are you here today? Are you here today? You already saved, but you need a church home. You come to Macedonia and kind of like this little place. You can hear God talking to you. You can see yourself born in this place. You can see yourself being blessed and being a blessing. You can see yourself on your way to your destiny in a place like this. This is your time. And if by chance, Macedonia is not your place, we'll help you get to your place of destiny. Are you here today? Would you come? You have a church home, but you know you just need to reconnect the right way, get a better connection in your relationship with Christ. If that's you, would you come? Would you come?
you until the evening service. And then the invitation is still open. Were you blessed by the word of God today? As we get ready to dismiss, I want to remind you that we're licensed to preach here this afternoon. We say that there will be an offering taken, an offering received.
We're going to take it from you.
We'll receive it. If you're making out a check, please make that check out to Radnisha Bean.
Amen.
If you want to know how to spell her name, it's in the bulletin, or ask her. Please don't ask me. After you have finished eating, those of you who need one, go get you a nap. Get you some rest. The church wears some of us out. Get you some rest. You are allowed to go wherever, get you a corner, go somewhere. Get you some rest. And come back refreshed at 3:30. Amen? Leaders, remember there's a meeting in the hill. And then we'll meet you down in the fellowship hall where food will be served as soon as you guys come down. And remember what we said on Wednesday, we are not going to act ugly.
Amen.
Just because we're serving food.
Amen.
We are an amazing church. Don't make us be ordinary by showing out because we are feeding. So we're going to go down and we're going to be decent and in order and loving and united. We're going to break bread, we're going to talk about good things.
Amen.
Then we're going to get ready for worship this afternoon. Amen?
Amen.
If by chance I come to you and I say something like this, where's the love? Or greetings. I need you to understand that I have seen something and I need you to kind of back up a little bit. Alright? And I'll do it 100% out of love. Alright? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you today for what our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard, what our heart has felt. Thank you for blessing this, your people. Thank you for teaching us that we can live outside our comfort zone. And when we're outside our comfort zone, you're going to give us some instructions.
Yes, Lord.
While we're outside our comfort zone and the instructions have been received, we need to walk in total faith. And once we walk in total faith, we will experience your presence. So we thank you for the word. We thank you for this, your people. We thank you for what you're continuing to do. As you're talking, as you're ministering, as you are breaking up fallow ground, in these, your people, let us, after the process, be more and more like you. We thank you, God, for the food that has been prepared.
Thank you, God.
For the nourishment of our bodies.
Thank you,
God. We thank you for fun.
Yeah.
We thank you for food. We thank you for good fellowship. We thank you, God, that we are united in Christ. We have brotherly love and it will continue today. We thank you right now that all will be well with everyone in every situation. And after we have nourished our bodies, after you've allowed us to get rest, we thank you, God, for allowing us to assemble again at 3:30.
Yeah, yeah.
So that we can witness what you have done in the life of a preacher.
Amen.
We thank you for all those that are coming this way. And all those who are here, and we collectively are ready to give your name glory.
Yes, sir.
Give your name honor.
Yes, sir.
And give your name praise.
Uh-huh.
We thank you right now. In Jesus' name.
Yes.
And all of God's people together said,
amen.
Amen. Hug somebody, tell them you love them.